You are watching DHTV, the television program service of California State University, Dominguez Hills.
Welcome to Sociology 101, The Individual and Society. My name is Sergio Soto, and thank you for joining us today. Today's discussion will revolve around deviance and a little bit on crime and punishment. But before we get started, this is our sixth session. As many of you know, here on this broadcast class, this lecture, everyone is welcome to participate. So if you want to call in and ask a question, if you have something you would like to share or point out, please call 800-339-1193. You can also send your messages via email at askdhtv@gmail.com. And everyone's welcome. You know, again, this is sociology, the study of society. We all live in society. We all, carry out our daily lives, in this social world. So we all have something to contribute. We can all relate to at least one aspect or many of the aspects within this class. And, you know, deviance is something that we all understand, something that we all can relate to in some aspect. So the study of deviant behavior. Within sociology, the dichotomy between deviance and normality, or what's normal, is something that we often try to understand, right? And it's what we've been, dealing with for, since the beginning of the class, right? So we'll refresh everyone's memories and introduce some new individuals to some of our terminology. So norms, right? Our definition for norms are the definite principles or rules people are expected to observe. They represent the do's and don'ts of society. It's also important to consider whose rules or norms people deviate from. So who sets the rules? What are these rules? You know, how do we understand them? This is something we've been discussing from the beginning. But again, let's take a step back, right? When we think about deviance, we often think of it in only a negative context. And, for the most part, that's what we often highlight or kind of connect to social problems. But deviance is, to a certain extent, negative, but also in another aspect, neutral, right? So within our society, we need deviance, right? Although crime and usually when people are acting outside of, what's normative, it can be seen as a problem or weird. You also need deviance to let you know or reinforce these norms, right? How do you know you're doing something right or wrong? It's until you get that reaction, whether it's positively sanctioned, your behavior is positively sanctioned or negatively sanctioned. And it's also, deviance is something that occurs when people innovate, right? When we introduce Merton strain theory, we'll talk about this innovation and how it can lead some folks into a life of crime, or lead some folks into discovering new ways of doing things and new ways of living. And our first video is going to explore some of this, right? We're going to explore the world of dumpster diving, right? And as you watch this video, kind of consider what norms are being broken, or maybe even your own reaction, right? To a certain extent, we don't really realize the influence of norms until we see a deviant act or those norms challenged. Some of you might have a biological reaction to some of this. You might gag or have to look away from the television at just considering the idea of eating from a garbage dumpster. But again, this is something people do as a way of life, as political activism, and perhaps it might be, you know, the new reality for, you know, some individuals, right? You know, maybe, you know, one reason people do this is to point out the excess that's associated with our consumerism and capitalism here in our society. So let's take a look at this video. It's a short one, and then we'll be right back and we'll discuss it.
I'm Professor Milton Sayer, teach at UCSD, and I've been a freegan for 30 years. I get a decent salary, I work in the university, I have an education, or I have a higher degree. I do hear comments from people who aren't used to the idea, like, ew, you got your food from the dumpster? That's very common. Very few people are aware of the benefits, other than just that you're getting free food. But few people think environmentally in our culture, I think. And as a result, they don't realize that there's really benefit for everybody. Freeganism came from two terms. One is free, and the other is vegan. So we end up with freegan. So I talked with a number of students who also seemed to be interested in environmental concerns, and we started a student faculty group.
Freeganism is an anti-consumer movement trying to oppose the excessive consumerism that is part of our society these days.
After attending his lecture, I went to go talk to him afterwards, and then he invited me to come along for a freegan dive.
I think it was pretty awesome that he found lots and lots of bottles of beer a couple weeks ago.
So pay attention. I'm going to now provide you with your first lesson in dumpster diving. You'll find fruits and vegetables. You'll find meat products. If the meat is frozen, then you know it's good. Frequently you find stuff without labels, in which case we call them mystery cans. We have no idea what's inside the mystery can.
This past week, we walked away with about $200 worth of produce.
I just go like this with bare feet. What'd you find over here, Justin?
Student
covers. Ooh. I will take one of those, actually.
We've got enough here so that we could put them in every pocket of every pair of pants we've got. Freeganism in general is anti-consumerism, and it means that you're supposed to reduce consumption whenever possible. That's number one. Oh, look what I just found, an umbrella. Now let's see if it works. Reuse anything that you do have. That's number two. And finally, recycle it if you can.
Welcome back. Okay, so there we saw freeganism in action, dumpster diving, and you can see how values, some values that are very normative in our society, like ones associated with environmentalism, are observed, but we also see deviant behavior, right? Or something that deviates from the norms. Like the norm in our society is that you don't go to a dumpster or a trash can for your food, you go inside the store. But as pointed out here, this is a mechanism that propels consumerism, and it's necessary for our, you know, we understand it, you know, or we've been taught this because of our economic system, right? You know, you might ask yourself, or you might want to share, you know, your perspectives. And again, you can always call in at 800, our 800 number, or you can write us in. Write us and, you know, tell us your, you know, reaction to this. Is this an acceptable idea, something that is new and revolutionary, right? Or do you see the normative function? Like maybe some of you were disgusted by the idea of, providing part of your sustenance to survive from stuff a store throws away, right? But again, you know, kind of think about how these norms work, how they alter behavior, and you know, and a couple other things were going on. You know, the professor there in this video was also chose not to wear any shoes. He chose to walk around barefoot. Right? Think about how norms, little subtle norms like that, work, right? But anyway, kind of think about that, and let's discuss that. Let's throw out a formal definition for deviance now. So deviance is nonconformity, right? To a given set of norms that are accepted by a significant number of people in a community or society, right? So a significant number, or sometimes the majority, observe these rules, right? And you know, the minority are the ones that, you know, their behavior when, again, judged by the dominant group or the dominant ideology, is seen as unacceptable or not, you know, the right way to do something, right? Because again, you know, we can explore what right and wrong is, and you know how that exists inside a spectrum. So, you know, when we think about deviance, we have to really examine, you know, how those rules work to shape society. And in the upcoming lectures, this will be extremely important when we start discussing race, inequality, and gender, right? Up until this point, we've been kind of dabbling in how inequality is reinforced or how it works in society, how it's systematic. But again, these norms, these values, these ideas help everyday individuals frame and understand the world in a certain way, right? You know, our biases or stereotypes or what we're prejudiced against or for are influenced by, you know, a whole value system, and norms are just another way that we experience them or that we have to, you know, react or confine ourselves to them, okay? So, again, deviance can occur in groups. You know, whenever we have cults, right? They're often seen as a deviant. You know, the group, you know, within subgroups or subcultures in society, there's certain activities. Like in the back, we see what is presumably, you know, some drug use. You know, it might be an important part of the culture, important part of the subculture. But in the dominant culture, it's a deviant. Or we can see when certain individuals are celebrated by a small section of the group, but the dominant, you know, discourse rejects this idea and maybe vilifies some of these individuals. Like, for instance, someone who might be a graffiti artist, and their value in the art world may not be recognized, but you know, a small group of people who follow that art movement might see it as something that is worthwhile and beautiful. Something else we can talk about is something like online, you know, hackers or hacktivists, right? You know, there's two ways of looking at it, right? Or a group like Anonymous. On one side, you know, the dominant or the media would argue that these individuals are, you know, criminals and they're putting everyone at risk. Others see and celebrate them as heroes, you know, pointing out, you know, different injustices or framing the world in a certain way, right? So again, deviance is, again, part of that discourse, part of that debate. So when we attempt to define deviance, you know, it can be problematic. You know, sociologists debate whether crime and deviance in the United States are functional or if they're, or if they've grown out of control. Right, so in one sense, you know, crime has been dropping, and again, when we think about deviance, you know, it's one of these things that, you know, sometimes people have to cross the line in order for us to understand, or it's indicative of a systematic, you know, feature in the system where, you know, people have to innovate or choose alternate pathways to achieve certain goals that aren't open to them. Right? For instance, one thing that we'll explore later on is, you know, what happens if you don't have the opportunities that, you know, everyone else presumably in society does, right? Like, what are your options if you are from a lower socioeconomic background and your neighborhood has very few job opportunities and perhaps all you have available to you is working fast food or something akin to that, something minimum wage? It might make sense for you to sell drugs or to, you know, participate in an illicit activity, right? This is just one of those viewpoints. Katie writes in regarding dumpster diving. Being frugal or trying to emphasize the waste of our country is one thing, but I think about the disease factors involved. You have to be willing to risk getting sick to do this, right? You know, so again, you know, if you have any questions, feel free to call in or write in just like Katie did. And true, you know, one of the things is this taking too, you know, a movement too far? Right? But the other side of it is, you know, a lot of the food that we throw away is still good, that we don't throw away, but stores and and other, that grocery stores and markets that are away, you know, all they need to do is, you know, to be washed, or they're really not dirty. You know, it's not more dirtier than when it's grown on the farm, right? You know, that's something that individuals who practice this would often point out, is that, you know, you might pick up a melon or some produce from the dumpster and you think it's dirty, but, you know, it's grown in the soil, so, and, you know, it's fed with fertilizer, which may include, you know, animal waste. So, you know, how dirty is it really, as opposed to, you know, being on a store shelf and, you know, dumpster? But again, you know, you bring up a good point, Katie. You know, a lot of our norms guiding, our hygiene, or how we, you know, sanitize our world, are, you know, a lot of it's motivated with our need to stay healthy and to stay alive. So, you know, something that might, you know, for example, something that's normalized and, you know, you inspire this thought, Katie, is, you know, washing your hands, right? You know, as a child, think about that process. And this is how, again, you learn norms. You're told you need to wash your hands. You're sanctioned if you don't wash your hands. Adults and, you know, people in authoritative positions often tell you, you know, the virtues of it, and, you know, discipline you when you don't, you know, perhaps wash your hands. And, you know, as an adult, you carry it on and you pass it along, right? To a certain extent, okay, that's something to protect, you know, yourself, but it's also formal, you know, a formal sanction, you know, that, you know, if you've worked in food preparation or in a restaurant or something like that, you know, there are rules and policies here in California that guide per county actually, but that guide the preparation of food and the sanitation of, the cleanliness of one's hands, right? So again, you know, we can really pick apart this whole process. Now, when we think back to Durkheim argued, and this is Emil Durkheim, you know, the founder of, the foundation, I should say, of structural functionalism. Durkheim argued that deviance was integral to a well-functioning society, because it outlined outlines to others that which is unacceptable. Thus, it should be eliminated rather than kept. Thus, it should not be eliminated, but rather kept within acceptable limits. Right. So, let me recap that idea. Right. So within structural functionalism, everything kind of has a function, so even deviance does, right? So, you know, we can look back to our example of, you know, dirty hands, right? Durkheim would argue that, you know, you would at least need children to have dirty hands once in a while, so you could police it, so everyone would see the importance of it when it's sanctioned, right? Or you can ask yourself a better, you know, another question. How do you know when that line, when you violate a norm, is crossed, right? When you or perhaps another person cross it, right? You know, for instance, if you have an instructor and you go to their class every day, you know, one of the norms that exists in our society is how we understand time and being punctual. So if you're late, right? How do you know it's a big violation? Well, maybe through the reaction of your instructor. Maybe they, you know, you lose points, your grade is affected, or maybe you're just disciplined in front of the whole group. So the function of that, even though, you know, that one person is disciplined in front of the whole group, it's a very public discipline. It's not only important to regulate the behavior of that person that came in late or that person that is, deviant, but it's also important to reinforce that norm within everybody who's observing, right? Ergo, you know, the whole saying of making an example out of someone. That example, you know, Durkheim would argue, is something that we need within society, because otherwise, how do we know where the lines that we can cross are, and how do we know how we can stay away from that or keep our distance from it? So, you know, for Durkheim, everything in moderation to a certain extent. So defining deviance down reflects changing societal standards for what is considered deviant. The other thing that we must understand as we explore this concept is that norms change, and through the evolution of society, the constant processes that we're subjected to, society, within society, the values and norms shift, they change, right? And right now, one of the things that we're beginning to observe, or that we observe within our society, is the changing of, or the, shifting of gender norms. So what we're going to watch right here is something that made, that got some media attention sometime last year or a year before that, with a little boy who painted his toenails pink, and was featured in a catalog for a clothing retailer. And some people felt certain ways about it. We'll let them video explain, and then we'll recap it when we come back. So let's watch this video together, and then we'll be right back.
This morning to discuss are psychologist and author of the Top 50 Questions Kids Ask, Dr. Susan Bartel, and parenting expert Shannon Ice. Good to have both of you with us.
Great to be here.
You're both parents as well, so you can weigh in on this into your perspective. Shannon, your kids are still pretty little. You have a daughter and a son. Mm-hmm. What do you think about it all?
I think children start to explore their sexuality in so many ways way before the age of 5. My son runs to the screen to kiss iCarly every time he sees her. My daughter is being questioned why I wear my hair short like boys, because her friends have said that. So they're exposed to a lot in an early age, and this gender conversation happens in a lot of different ways for them.
But should we be focusing on gender roles so early and trying to pinpoint our kids?
Absolutely not. We should be focusing on making our kids into good people, good friends, wonderful family members. Their gender is going to emerge naturally as part of who they are, mm-hmm. and it has nothing to do with whether or not we put pink nail polish on them.
Some folks have weighed in on both sides of this. A couple of people on our Facebook page wrote in to say that they had an issue with the picture. Rosalind says, quote, OMG, oh my God, that's just wrong. That poor kid is going to be bullied in school for that ad. Dee Dee agreed, writing, I can't believe that mother did that to her son and has him looking like a little girl. That kid will never live that down. Is that a valid concern, that by maybe encouraging your kids to do things which may not be seen as traditional, that it could be harmful for them in school and could cause them problems?
Actually, I think it's the opposite, that if we teach our children to be strong and to stand up for what they believe in, they are less likely to be targets of bullies than if we teach them to give in to everything that other people pressure them to do. They're much more likely to be seen as vulnerable then.
This comes up a lot, and especially since you have one of each in your household, Shannon. I've heard parents say, oh, you can't play with that. That's a toy that's only for boys, or that's only for girls. Mm-hmm. Is that something that is still ingrained in people's heads? Boys can only play with trucks, and girls can only play with dolls.
Well, a lot of it is just gender, neutral to them. They don't even understand. My son last night, sitting playing a Barbie game on our iPad, he doesn't care it's Barbie. He just knows he wants to beat his sister's score. So at the end of the day, they're just playing with each other. They're modeling each other's behaviors. They're modeling their parents' behaviors. We have a grooming basket in our house that our kids play with while they're helping me get ready, right? So they're doing their hair and all their different things because that's what they see mommy doing. So it's a very natural way to explore through play, and that's how they work.
And roles are changing anyway. Mm-hmm. When it comes to dads, a lot of dads stay home. My husband stayed home for 2 years with our older son.
Correct.
Dads do a lot of cooking now.
Correct.
They do a lot of
child
care.
So that should all be role modeled for kids. And those gender lines of what is supposed to be a girl thing and what's supposed to be a boy thing should be blurred. I think that's much better for kids to be growing up knowing that they can be empowered to work and do whatever boys do, and for boys to learn over the generations that they need to jump in and do what used to be girls' work so that families can work together and be a team.
The great thing about, whether there's controversy or not over a photo like this is it can really spark discussion. We don't even have to have a debate. It can spark discussion. I mean, is this something you think that would come up in your household, Shannon, with, pig nail polish on a little guy with your son?
It absolutely is. And much to my, husband's chagrin for the moment, my son had his fingernail polish on his fingernails because my daughter painted it. And that happens quite a bit. She dresses them up. And we take pictures, of course, right? That's at the beginning of your book.
He's going to love it when you bring those pictures out later on. And some people are concerned about the picture coming out later on. Is this something that you should legitimately be concerned about, whether it's, your daughter painting your son's nails or,
I think that parents and kids need to be careful about what they put online on Facebook and places like that, and we need to be teaching our kids that. But something like this is not going to come back in later years. He's a little boy. Again, he needs, and his mom need to make the decisions together what works for them, and he needs to learn how to stand up for himself. And if anyone does comment on it, there are lots of things that get commented on by other kids to kids, and you need to stand up for what you believe in. So I don't think that later on this is even going to register anyone or be relevant. And for now, they need to do what works for their family, and it's important for other people not to judge and to recognize that gender identity comes from inside. It doesn't come from something that you put on your toenails. Susan Bartel.
Welcome back. So there we see some norms challenged, some gender norms, and you can ask yourself, okay, is this appropriate or not, right? And we'll, you know, let's take some time to explore this idea. Now, we saw the virtues of this. This child can explore their, the world a little bit more freely if gender norms aren't, applied, or they're not restricted by them. And this little boy can now, have pink toenails and play with a Barbie game. But at the same time, there are, concerns that are present. And again, it's because we all have to live within society. One of the things that you might, and I'm trying to kind of spin it so you can kind of have another viewpoint, right? One of the things to kind of think about is that, when we think about like bullying or sanctions within the world, there's a normative function, right, buried in there. So, one of the mistakes is to just presume when people bully or, regulate behavior and like gender norms and things like that, that we assume that there's some kind of dysfunction, within the person's psychology. But that, what we really should, kind of discuss is how it functions within culture, because again, all those gender roles on whether your child can play with a Barbie toy or not, or whether they can have, a little boy can have, pink toenails are rooted in our concepts of masculinity and femininity. And, we talked about this process of socialization, and through this process of socialization, we begin to understand who we are and what the social expectations that exist in society, how those are going to be applied to our everyday life, right? So, if you're a parent, and say your child wants to wear pink toenail, finger paint on, paint their fingernails pink. If you're a parent, you have to wonder, okay, one, yes, you are liberating your child, but at the same time, what do you risk? If they go to school like that, will the other children be as progressive? And does your child or do the folks who teach your children have the tools to, explain, how, gender is a social construction and, it's okay, what a person wears on their nails or on their body doesn't define their character or their morality, right? Extremely difficult. So we do have another comment that came in regarding the freeganism. Madeline writes in, dumpster diving for me would depend on the city I'm in. I would choose to go through the dumpsters of a city that has a reputation for being cleaner than downtown LA. Would you ever dumpster dive? I would, and to a certain extent have. One thing, if you're curious in exploring, this way of life or this phenomenon is, that some well-known or retailers, I think Whole Foods and Trader Joe's, my information might be old. If someone knows, they can write in. They don't lock up their dumpsters, or they separate the type of garbage that they have so it doesn't mix with chemicals, because some places will like pour bleach and things like that just so people can't eat it. But some places do encourage it. They don't police it, right? They don't really advertise it because, again, when things get thrown out, if people found out, it hypothetically could hurt their business. Like if you knew they throw out day old bread, why would you, if you don't mind day old bread, why would you wait around and why would you buy new bread when you can just wait for it to be thrown out? Now, this issue of cleanliness also, comes up, but, you can also think about class. If these stores that, like Whole Foods, throw out or allow people to dumpster dive, right? You can kind of wonder, okay, well, what neighborhoods do we find these Whole Foods at? Are they the ones where perhaps the population is the hungriest, right? You know, we can be critical about this. Is this just middle class adventurism, right? You know, these are all issues that do come up. But again, you know, I would say not everywhere is, you know, a very sanitary place to, you know, harvest, you know, or reap what is thrown out. There are some venues that are much better, but I'm sure, you know, if you're really interested, you can do some independent research and find out for yourself. But again, you know, if you cook it at the right temperature, you know, it should be fine as long as you know, somewhat what you're doing, right? I just don't want to get anyone sick or anything. But again, you know, the point of it is to kind of think about the norms, right? And, you know, some of the other aspects, because again, you know, they're, you know, these folks are doing it as a, you know, environmental statement. You know, is that better than someone who's just doing it because they're hungry, right? You know, there's politics, you know, wrapped up in there as well, right? And identity politics, right? So anyway, moving forward, let's talk about norms and sanctions again. We define norms, but one of the things that we should understand, or hopefully we'll try to make very clear, is how sanctions work. Sanctions are any reaction, right? Any reaction from others to the behavior of an individual or group that is meant to ensure that that the person or group complies with the given norm. So this complicity can be a positive or negative sanction. A positive sanction is offering of rewards for conformity, and a negative is punishment for behavior that does not conform, right? So, you know, think about your education. You know, education is, you know, rife with sanctions, right? You know, if you do well and you conform to the behavior and you do your work, right, you follow this model, you might get not only a good grade, but you might get star, you know, stickers, or, you know, this is when you're young, stickers, your name on the board in a positive aspect, and you might get accolades. You know, not much else changes, you know, when you're an adult, right? When people get Employee of the Month, you can ask, okay, why did they get it? And what purpose does it serve? Well, if you get Employee of the Month or, you know, Student of the Month, right? To a certain extent, it's telling the other students or employees that they should model their behavior according to what you're doing and what that student or Employee of the Month has done, right? And on the other side, so those are positive sanctions, right? You can have negative ones, punishment for behavior that does not conform. So, you know, I don't know if they do this, but when I was in elementary school, if you acted up or if you were not complying to the authority figures in the classroom, you would have to, you know, do standards, or you would be openly and publicly, you know, disciplined, you know, for your behavior. Perhaps you even were sent to, you know, the principals or to the deans, so, you know, or you were, you know, had to call your mother home. These are all sanctions. And again, you know, and as adults, we have these same sanctions as well. People can get fired, or we have formal sanctions, right? Because again, these sanctions can be informal or formal. You know, we have laws and policies that can land a person, you know, in jail, or, you know, they could be given a fine and, you know, for a certain behavior, right? So we're going to watch right now is a very short example of an informal sanction. We'll watch the video and then discuss it afterwards. Kind of keep, you know, kind of think about how the sanctions are working, what's being sanctioned. There's two behaviors that are being sanctioned. And how is it kind of, you know, how is society or how is culture underneath all that, and how, you know, we can expose it when we kind of put our sociological lens and apply it to this situation. So let's take a look at that now, and then we'll be right back.
Messiah, you're not a single lady, buddy. Yes. Oh, yeah, you are. Yeah, yes, you are. Single, you're a single lady. Oh! Sorry. Sorry.
You're
buddy,
a
I was just kidding.
Lady.
I was just
you
kidding.
Can do it.
You can do it. Buddy, I'm sorry. I'm so sorry, buddy. You're a single lady, okay? Okay? Here we go.
If you like it, then you got a better ring on it.
If you like it,
sorry.
Did that hurt your feelings?
Welcome back. Okay, so there we saw a everyday situation. We saw an instance where a child sanctioned for their behavior, right? For this child, we know a little bit about development. They're in the play states. They're mimicking. It's imitation, right? The way this child understands the situation is everyone's dancing to this music. The child might not even understand the ramifications of a boy or male dancing to this song that presumably within culture is reserved for single ladies, right? So, when the father says, you're not a single lady, that's a negative sanction. You basically don't dance, right? And again, this is part of this process of socialization. What this father is doing is like reinforcing social norms, right, about gender, okay? And we have to wonder, this is a function, right? An everyday function that, we've all experienced in one way or the other, right? So with this negative sanction, gender is being policed. Now, everyone in the car kind of gave him a scowl. Again, this is the other negative sanction that occurred within this video. He got dirty looks, things like that, because the other people in the car understood that, here's a child. The child doesn't really understand the situation. It's pure innocence. It's play. But because he chose to police that, maybe he is a bad father. Well, I mean, bad or good, even the definition of what a good father is and what a bad father is subject to societal interpretation and to, these dominant forces that influence our lives, right? Again, we have to think about where they come from and how they function within the discourse, okay? So when we think about formal, right, these are informal sanctions. When we think about formal sanctions, we can think about laws, right? These are norms defined by governments as principles that their citizens must follow. Sanctions are used against people who do not conform to them. And when we think about crime, right, this is any type of behavior that breaks the law, right? So again, as we go through this, if you have any comments, you can always call in or write in. Our phone lines are open and our email channels are open as well. So again, you don't have to be part of the class to comment on this, but again, we welcome everyone. So one thing we want to explore is how laws emerge, right? Like for instance, when we have these formal processes of, regulating and sanctioning behavior with laws, crimes, we have to wonder, okay, how do crimes get defined and eventually legislation becomes adopted to regulate this behavior? So we're going to explore how, one of the new laws that might be affecting a lot of you, and it's linked to technology, right? Our laws surrounding texting while driving. So what we're going to watch now is a video. We're going to think about, okay, how this act is constructed. What is the motivation for formalizing laws to regulate this behavior? And if people don't, follow this behavior or don't conform to this, to not texting and driving, right? Don't conform to what the state wants, how they're now legally sanctioned, right? And whether, what the purpose is, right? Every law, every norm has a function, has a purpose, right? Sometimes in this, it might be clearer than with other cases, like when we think about norms. So let's watch this and then we'll be right back.
18-year-old's final Facebook message that was tragically prophetic. Taylor Sauer posted to a friend that she had to stop riding because she was driving. Well, soon after, she ran into a tanker truck and was killed instantly. Well, now her parents are turning their loss into a mission to save others. We're going to talk to them in just a moment, but first, here's NBC's Kristen Dahlgren.
The only thing brighter than 18-year-old Taylor Sauer's smile was her personality.
She's just such a big life.
There was no ignoring Taylor.
Always bubbly and high-spirited and crazy.
She was a champion softball player. Once got the whole school to raise money for breast cancer research. And when she was named Distinguished Scholar last year, she told the local TV station her plans.
Leave and go farther and take on the world.
She was studying to be an elementary teacher. But on January 14th, driving home from college on a lonely and straight stretch of Idaho's Interstate 84, Taylor was Facebooking. A fun conversation about the Denver Broncos, and then one final post. I can't discuss this matter now. Driving and Facebooking is not safe. Ha ha.
There was no evidence of any braking whatsoever.
Taylor hit a semi-truck right in front of her. The truck was going just 15 miles an hour. Taylor, more than 80.
I kind of felt like it was my fault.
Mike Collette didn't know his friend was driving until he got that last message.
You picture your heart and then there's just a big chunk of it's gone.
For her family, the pain is indescribable.
It's quiet. It's really quiet.
But they soon realize Taylor might just have one more thing to tell the world.
This is how it can end.
And so just weeks after her death, they took that message to the state capitol.
What if that one person was your daughter?
Idaho is one of just 13 states still without an outright ban on texting while driving. It's been voted down in the past, opponents claiming the state already has inattentive driving laws.
Taylor's mom compares it to the seatbelt law. There was a time when many thought the government shouldn't force us to buckle up, but for most of us now, it's just second nature.
I don't know if it would have saved Taylor, but I know it'll save the younger ones that grow up with it being a law.
A family still fighting together, inspired by the daughter they'll never forget, and the final words they want everyone to remember. For today, Kristen Dahlgren, NBC News.
Welcome back. So there we see, we just watched a video where, you know, laws were created or were actually, you know, here in the state of California, we have this law, but attempts to get this law, you know, passed in Texas were, you know, were being backed by this, you know, particular incidents, this awareness, right? And like the reporter pointed out, you know, at one time many people, you know, would drive without a seatbelt. But again, you know, laws and modifying behavior, you know, and their function to modify behavior is something that's been recognized, right? Something that works. But again, you know, it brings up questions of, you know, how much power we might want our government entities to have over us and whatnot. Katie writes in, I'm sorry, it seems that most laws and rules are not put into effect until a problem arises, right? Once things become repeated and have negative effects, then something is done, right? And again, if you have any questions or comments yourself, you can call in or write in. And it's true, you know, one of the ways our, you know, system works or even norms work, it's, you know, you have to discover an issue, you have to discover a problem before you can, you know, actually define it, right? So although, you know, some people might say this was a long time coming, right? You know, it's also a process that takes time, right? And again, you know, when we think about social problems, right, when we try to define problems, it's all about who gets to decide, you know, what the problem is or how it's defined, because someone could have just as easily argued, well, it might have been the excess of speed or maybe youth, you know, that's one of the arguments, you know, why young people pay more in insurance rates, right? But anyhow, that's just one aspect on how laws are influenced by, you know, how people perceive a problem, how people understand how, you know, certain sanctions might be necessary in order to alter behavior, okay? Now, another note, subcultures might have their own sets of norms and standards. We talked about this before. They can conflict with the dominant culture. We'll take a little bit of time and just really briefly to acknowledge the biological view of deviance, right? Early on, there were attempts to identify deviant behavior through biology, biological and physical characteristics. But again, a lot of that early research was, skewed by sexism and racism and, really just bad science. However, modern psychology does associate certain personality types or particular types of personalities to deviant behaviors, right? At its pinnacle, or the pinnacle, is probably something like the psychopath, right? An individual who's withdrawn, an emotionless character who delights in the violence for its own sake, or one step below, the sociopath, someone who is, free of empathy for others, right? One of the arguments is that, because people have predispositions to certain behavior, depending on the, environmental influences, some people may be more predisposed to deviance than others, right? But again, when we discuss sociopaths, it can be problematic, right? Someone might, turn to mass murder or violence because, they're labeled as a sociopath and they don't feel any empathy for another person. But, the freedom from empathy is also something that might be rewarded in our society, like aggression, or, we'll talk about aggression next, but within business, you can't have very much remorse for the people you compete with, right? Otherwise, you put yourself at a disadvantage. When we think about aggression is linked to crime and deviance, right? We can think about like testosterone, and that's one of the arguments why young men, are much more likely to commit crimes. But at the same time, we can think about how culture influences our understanding of deviance, right? Masculinity in our society embraces aggression, or aggression is something that is rewarded in certain aspects of life, like within organized sports, right? So moving forward, we're going to explore some sociological theories. And the first theories we're going to explore or revisit are the functionalist theories. Functionalists see crime and deviance resulting from structural tensions and the lack of moral regulation in society. This lack of moral regulation should remind you of, again, of Durkheim and anomie, right? Or being anomic. Again, anomie exists when there are no clear standards to guide behavior, and under such circumstances, people feel disoriented and anxious, right? When people, feel lost or feel disassociated with society, or they lose their status, this anomic, anomie can overtake them. But again, going back to something we, talked about earlier, deviance has a function, right? It not only causes people to, commit crimes and things like that, but deviance can be adapted. It can bring new ideas, it can present new ideas that bring about change, right? Whenever we learn about some of our inventors or, the captains of industry that change society, we often learn how they are taught how, the history of how they went against the grain, or how they didn't listen to, the dominant views on what they should do with their life. For instance, an individual like Bill Gates, dropped out of Harvard, right? That was a deviant act, right? So again, deviance does serve a function. It changes society. The other is the boundary mechanism, boundary maintenance, right? It lets us know the difference between good and bad behavior, right? So there's a function there. So this brings us to Robert Merton, right? And modified anomie. And for Merton, and what we're really going to talk about is strain theory. Strain is put on an individual's behavior when accepted norms conflict with social reality. So when the norms conflict with social reality, and thus deviance is a byproduct of economic inequality and relative deprivation. So economic inequalities, again, you know, not everyone starts off in the same social position. And relative deprivation is this concept that, you know, you are entitled to something or a resource in society, but you are denied full access to it. So there are five possible reactions according to Robert Merton. One is conformity. Most people will conform, right? Even though they might not have access to the same, they might not be have the same advantage economically, you know, to speak, right? So most of us conform in society. You know, that's something, you know, many of you may have suspected already. The fact that many of you are taking a class, right, is conforming, right? And when we think about Merton, you know, we have, you know, Merton points out that the goals in our society often outweigh the means, right? So you're willing to bend the means in order to achieve those goals. Like, for instance, we all have this desire within our society to be successful, okay? And often that success is measured by economic prosperity or our wealth, you know? So, you know, we all, to a certain extent, want to be rich, but we don't all have access to the same avenues to get there, right? Or to achieve our success. So most people, okay, are conformists, right? And they conform to the mean, right? We understand the goal. They accept that goal of being economical, you know, economically, have prosperity, economic prosperity. And the means to achieve it is something like going to school, right? Many of you will be here in this class, you know, are taking this class because you're conforming to the means, the accepted ways of achieving that goal within society. This is conformity. This is conformist behavior, right? Now, we understand that. Okay, so you conform to the goals and you conform to the means. Now, innovators, right, accept norms but find illegitimate ways to try to achieve them, right? So innovators accept the goals within society. Like, you know, for instance, we were using an example of economic prosperity. So, you know, if someone doesn't have, or someone has the avenue blocked off to achieve this goal, like say that, you know, they were given a education that is not up to par, or the only jobs that they have in their community are, you know, minimum wage jobs or jobs that aren't really careers, they may choose to, you know, think outside the box. They may choose to sell drugs, right? You know, some other deviant or criminal act, right? Because they accept the goals, but they reject the means and innovate new means, right? For Merton, he saw the deviance or the, you know, deviance in American society directly related to our overemphasis in the goals, right? But again, you know, innovation isn't necessarily negative. Like when we think about it within the framing of crime, it can also be, you know, a positive thing, right? When people come along and think of a new way of doing things, right? They accept the goals, right, of achieving something, but adopt new means, right? And the new means can be adopted elsewhere. To a certain extent, this class is, you know, the result of someone's innovation rejecting the traditional means of, you know, having a university class or a sociology class within a traditional classroom, but instead innovated a new way that, you know, has proven itself, right? Ritualists, right? One of the other possible ways to react to this deprivation is rituals abandon competitive outlook and reject the ritualists conform to standards but have lost sight of the values behind them. So, you know, these are folks who reject the goals but accept the means, right? So, you know, society tells you, okay, you know, in order to get ahead, in order to be prosperous in our society, you must go to college, you must go to the university, you must get a degree and become successful, right? you know, someone who is a ritualist may not believe in this gold anymore, but since it's accepted mean, they go along with it, right? They conform to the mean, right? The ritual of doing things, right? They may feel this is not the best way to do it, but do not seek ways of innovating outside of it, right? And again, you know, this could be a good thing, right? Keeps people in line. If everyone is a ritualist, no one rocks the boat. But at the same time, if everyone's a ritualist, you know, one of the drawbacks to it is that society never evolves and never innovates. It stays the same. Retreatists, right? Abandon competitive outlook and reject dominant values, right? This is an individual who would have rejected the means in society and the goals, right? These are people who retreat into themselves. Sometimes their behavior is associated with, you know, drug abuse or, you know, but basically, you know, these are the folks who may not be motivated in society, may, you know, be labeled deviant because of their lack of motivation or lack of wanting, right? And the third is rebellion. The fifth is rebellion, right? We've gone through all five. This is where an individual rejects existing values and seeks to replace them with new ones. So kind of similar to retreatists, right? A retreatist might choose to give up to say and, you know, do their own thing. Someone who rebels creates new means and new goals, right? So a person might, you know, reject education and, you know, reject this concept of, you know, material success and choose to go off and find their own way, right? Rebel. So, you know, maybe even our video at the very beginning with the Freegans is an example of rebellion, right? Where an individual decides to choose new means and new objectives in, you know, feeding themselves. But anyway, we'll explore next a subcultural explanation of deviance, right? So contradictions in American society creates subcultural groups that adopt norms that encourage or reward criminal behavior, right? So for instance, economic inequalities can prevent people from, you know, achieving certain opportunities, and these contradictions will, you know, make people realize that they're either against the system or labeled a different way, right? One of the criticisms is that it can be leveled against an idea that all groups do not share the same aspirations as the white middle class. So, you know, getting an education and getting all of this, you know, is something that is, you know, the dominant view. But again, you know, it may not be what your community, you know, how your community identifies. So they may, you know, gravitate to more deviant behavior because it's something that not only is an act of resistance against the dominant view, but also, you know, something that they can use to identify. So anyway, when we think about, as we start exploring interactionist theories, you know, we're going to start exploring how this, how deviance is a social construction. It's a socially constructed phenomenon. And to kind of wrap up some of these ideas that we just explored, we're going to watch a short video on Gang Leader for a Day. We're going to explore what that was like for this particular sociologist. And we'll be right back with the rest of our lecture.
In the late 1980s and early 1990s, there was a phrase that was used in the news a lot, the gang and drug problem. And we really didn't know what the gang and drug problem was. And Gang Leader for a Day is a book about my time trying to get inside the world of gangs, inside the world of drug dealing, inside the world of a poor community, to help people understand what life was like from the inside. The project started in a way that I could never have predicted and probably would never want to have happen again. I was asking a bunch of street gang members some questions in a poor community, trying to be a good sociologist. They didn't believe that I was a sociologist. They thought I was a rival Mexican street gang member, and they held me hostage in the stairwell for 24 hours. And when they felt it was safe to let me go, they told me, you know what, you really need to live with people. You can't ask them silly questions and hope you're going to get the real answers to life around here. I took that as an invitation, and I came back. I met the street gang leader, JT, and the book is really the chronicle of the journey between me and JT for the better part of 7 or 8 years. JT was kind of an anomaly. He had a college degree, he worked in a corporation, and he decided to come back to his neighborhood to run the street gang. And when I heard that part about his background, I wanted to know more. And we basically hung out with each other. And I think a lot of the ways in which I was able to gain trust and access was because of his own background as somebody who had a college degree, who had worked in mainstream America. And he looked at me as someone who might be able to tell his story to the rest of the world. It's not surprising when you think about the Robert Taylor Homes why a big crack dealing gang would end up there. 40,000 people. It's a community that's very, very poor and desperate. They can't rely on the government. They can't rely on foundations. They don't have services. Politicians aren't listening to them. So sometimes they turn to the gang for help. So the very same gang that's dealing crack, that's really, really violent, also has money. And they turn it back to the residents by giving them small, you know, bits of cash here and there to get to win their favor, basically. And so the book is really about that difficult place that people are in when they have to turn to a gang in order to survive. One day I approached the street gang leader, JT, and I said, listen, I don't see what's so difficult about your job. You basically stand around and give people orders all day. And he said, okay, well, why don't you try it? And so for one day, I became a kind of gang leader for a day. And I didn't shoot any guns or I didn't do anything illegal, but I had a chance to walk with him and see the kinds of difficult things that he had to do. Even little things like trying to find a place for 250 guys to meet, which is not so easy when you're doing illegal things. So it gave me a real inside look at some of the decisions that go into leading a 250 person crack dealing street gang. I felt really blessed throughout my work because people really trusted me. They gave me a lot of access. They let me stay in their homes. They watched over me if there was periods of violence. This is a community that when you look at them on TV, it may seem like another world, like people that are really different than you and me. But I think what I learned is that we have a lot more in common than we think. And those commonalities really go across race divides, ethnic divides, and even social class. I never thought that I'd be learning as much about from poor people in the US that I did, but at that stage in my life, that's really who helped me become a better person. The book is really about a community where people have to actually rely on a street gang to survive day to day. Imagine what that's like when the street gang becomes the person or the group that you go to get money, to get services, to get help. That's an awful way to live. And that's the...
Welcome back. So right there we see, a little bit about the life of not only this sociologist, but what he experienced during his research. And a couple things were brought up that will help us frame some of the next two topics that we're going to discuss, labels and the environment. But again, if you have any questions, comments that you'd like to contribute, you can always call in 800-339-1193, or you can write us in at askdhtv@gmail.com. So the next kind of theory that we want to explore is differential association, right? In a society that contains a variety of subcultures, some environments tend to encourage illegal activities, whereas others do not, right? So in another sense, criminal behavior is a learned rational response. It's not a psychological aberration. So people learn deviance. They learn it as either a survival mechanism or as the accepted behavior inside a subgroup or community. We just finished watching a short video where, life inside government subsidized housing or government housing or in a lower socioeconomic area, kind of produces, new sets of norms and new understandings of a person's relationship, not only between their government, but also between the members of their community. Right? So when we think about how deviance is learned, right, it's what people are surrounded by. It's about, what people do and how they understand the behavior that either gets them by or that they will learn to identify with, right? So, if you grow up in a home where people make their living skirting the law or through criminal activity, you know, it becomes more acceptable, if not the accept the means of, providing for oneself. Whereas, you know, a more conforming household might, you know, expect children to go to university, expect them to get high grades. And again, you know, those are another set of norms because, you know, certain opportunities are not blocked off to them. Or because, you know, that's what the parents did before them or the people in the community. Even, you know, our social expectations, right? You know, if you live in a community and your neighbors are doctors and lawyers, you know, how you frame yourself or your future, you know, would be akin to what they're achieving, right? You expect, your expectation is that you are able to be a doctor or a lawyer, whereas in another, you know, lower socioeconomic neighborhood, maybe the person with the best job is someone who works in sanitation. So what you strive for is, you know, is that. So, a lot of different ways to kind of, view this perspective. Another that's closely associated with this symbolic interaction, this kind of paradigm, is labeling theory. So labeling theory is an approach to the study of deviance that suggests that people become deviant because of certain labels that are attached to their behavior by political authorities and others. To a certain extent, you know, self-fulfilling prophecy is a phenomenon that people, display, right? One of the mysteries of, you know, humans is that we like to conform. We have this innate part of ourselves that wants to conform, even if it works, you know, against our, you know, ourselves, right? So when we think about labeling, it's, you know, people being told that they're, you know, bad or good. You know, sometimes it's just, it's simple as that, right? You know, there's a psychological and sociological influence that, you know, impacts people even at a young age. You know, children that are told that they're good, that they're bright, that they're going places will, embrace that thought and, you know, conform their behavior accordingly. You know, and again, the same research shows that, you know, children who are seen as inferior or told they're inferior, treated as that, you know, or told they're bad, will embrace the other side of the spectrum, right? So when we think about different types of deviation, right? Primary deviance is the initial act of aggression, but someone doesn't adopt that, a label necessarily upon the first act of deviance, right? We can think of, the act of theft, right? A lot of folks who are watching this program right now have stolen something, right? Myself included, I've stolen things in my youth, but I don't label myself a criminal, right? So one of the questions that we, start to ask is, okay, when do people adopt this behavior? Like if you were, watching this class, you know, one of your statuses might not be, criminal, right? Because maybe you've stolen something, or cheater because you've maybe once, you know, looked up an answer when you shouldn't have during the test. Right? You know, it's not until it's the, you know, this deviation, this act of deviance becomes, frequent, or until a person is labeled by a dominant authority. So secondary deviance, when a person comes to accept the label, right? And begins to see themselves as a deviant. The secondary deviation is what really kind of, guides a person into conforming into another set of norms, right? Deviant norms, right? Because again, you know, even when you deviate, you might be conforming to, this concept of deviance that is, again, you know, perpetuates in society. So, you know, it's one is based on frequency and the other is based on labels, right? So some critique, right? We always have to keep in mind that no behavior is intrinsically criminal, but is denied as such by political authorities and those in power, right? Whether something's good or wrong, it's politics. And when we talk about politics in this course, it's not necessarily, you know, Democrat or Republican. You know, the idea of politics is that it's the conversation, it's the function of telling someone they can and can't do this or that, right? So politics by its very nature is normative or establishing norms. So when we think about this, you know, we have to ask, okay, well, where do these norms come from and how do they really work, right? What's the purpose of them? And, you know, when we think about deviation, right, everyone, you know, some people have, are labeled deviant from the start, right? They really have no kind of agency to alleviate themselves from it. You know, we'll start to explore this a little further when we talk about race. And again, there's no clear, we talked about critics point out the theory does not address what leads to the acts of deviant behavior, right? This is another critique for labeling theory. And often the behavior precedes the label. And there's no evidence that labeling increases deviant behavior. So again, this is labeling theory. Now we'll move on to the conflict perspective. Deviance is deliberately chosen and is often political in nature in response to inequalities within the capitalist system. So within new criminology, deviance is deliberately chosen by the powerful and is political in nature. It reflects inequality in society and maintains the privileges of the powerful, right? So certain people are policed more than others. We'll explore this when we talk about race and class. Think about how people are labeled or how people have statuses of rich or poor. You know, some folks are policed more than others. You know, if you're poor, if you're a minority, or if you're a young male, chances are that you are more susceptible to an encounter with law enforcement than someone who is your opposite in one of these categories, right? When we think about crime in the lower socioeconomic areas, it might be an act of resistance, right? To the fact that, you know, a lot of people are alienated by the government, which they are, on paper, the government they belong to or the society they belong to, right? So, you know, if, you know, like we watched in our video, you might turn to alternative ways of seeing the world and living if you are not having your needs met, right? Another theory, control theory, right? And this tends to be, the preferred theory of law enforcement. Crime results from an imbalance between impulses towards criminal activity and the social and physical control that deter them. And a lot of this is based on the work of Travis Hershey, who argues that humans are selfish and constantly make rational decisions that weigh benefit and risks. When the bonds that link people to a society are strong, attachment, commitment, involvement, and beliefs, delinquency and deviance are rare. So this is a concept that, when we think about laws and crime, there has to be a sanction strong enough to prevent us from committing those acts, right? You know, one of the premises of this is that most people, may give in to their impulses to maybe steal or take something, but it's the barriers that we put in place or the sanctions that exist that, you know, when we make this cost-benefit analysis, prevent most people from enacting on that impulse. Like, for instance, locks on the door, right? You know, a lock on the door isn't really gonna protect your things from them being taken forcefully, but it will, you know, deter most people. As a matter of fact, you know, you don't try this. This is not like a social, you know, don't do it for a social experiment, but, you know, even when your door is, you know, closed, right? Most people assume that the door is locked, right? That's a hurdle. That's a barrier, right? You know, and again, you know, it's about fortifying, access to these things, so it becomes much more difficult for people to achieve that reward that they seek. Or on the other side, we have these sanctions, right? You know, something like speeding, right? When you drive down the freeway or, you know, You know, you might see a sign that says, you know, either, you know, don't go past, you know, over the speed limit because the fine is this much. Don't text and drive. It's, you know, it's not worth it. You know, the fine is like over $200. Or, you know, buckle up, the fine is $500, right? That possible sanction keeps us from, you know, committing that behavior. Because if it's too low, you might say, it's only $5. I'll break the law this time, right? But anyway, some theorists see increased opportunity as the primary motivation for the factor as well. You know, for example, you know, if a certain deviant act is very rewarding, right? It's hard to refuse. You know, for instance, your book will argue that, you know, some criminals are, you know, pressured or by this yearning to maybe commit burglary if they see an increasing number of vacant homes with high-end consumer electronics, which, you know, provide a very hefty reward, right? And very, you know, and they don't see very many obstacles, you know, in their way. So, you know, one way we can see this emerging in our society is, you know, this reaction where we now have this fortress mentality, you know, that's emerged within the wealthier subsections of society that feel that they must defend themselves against the criminal element in society. So we see an increasing amount of, you know, gated communities and things of this nature, right? So, you know, if you live inside a gated community, you feel safe. Control theory will argue, okay, you're safer because it's a lot harder for someone to, you know, who might, you know, want to take your things to have access to you. But at the same time, you know, and this is maybe going back to, you know, a more conflict Marxist-oriented perspective, you know, when you see whole groups of people blocking themselves off or isolating themselves from the rest of society, you know, it creates, you know, us versus them mentality. So at the same time, you know, people feel alienated or alienate these individuals because they don't share, you know, they block themselves off in the community, and, you know, they maybe they don't feel as bad, or maybe they see it as a form of social justice if they, you know, burglarize some of these homes. But anyway, just kind of different ways of thinking about it. But anyway, fortifying a target is, you know, something that's associated with control theory. Think about the locks, security alarms, things of that nature. Their main purpose is deterrence, because again, if you make the reward harder to attain, more people will be less likely to, you know, go after that. You know, it's the same thing with car alarms or, you know, steering wheel locks. Another theory, the broken windows theory, right? Any sign of social disorder in a community, even broken windows, can encourage the rise of serious crime, right? Now, to help explain this, we're going to watch a short video on broken windows theory, and then we'll be right back and we'll continue our discussion. So let's watch that video now.
Some more recent sociological approaches, called control theories, are more modest in their ambitions. If societies cannot be changed, maybe the social spaces in which crime flourishes can be changed. Wilson and Kelling's Broken Windows was probably the most influential article ever written on crime prevention. They argued that crime and disorder are closely related.
Broken windows is a theory that cues of neighbourhood decline, such as physical features, graffiti, vandalism and so on, give residents in an area the feeling that the area is going downhill.
Wilson and Kelling suggested that the physical environment then also had an impact on fear of crime, on people's sense of safety, and people's sense of worth.
Well, if it's quite a run-down area and you saw a lot of broken windows, it'd imply that there was maybe squatters or there was quite a lot of violence.
It is worrying because you feel like you've always got to be on your guard when you go out anywhere.
There used to be all people going in and out to see what they could get out of the empty houses, what people had left, or kids smashing the windows, as you can see, well, the windows are broken.
As fear builds up and informal social control goes down, it allows petty crime to infiltrate, which further increases fear. So you start to get a spiral of decline.
The reason that Wilson and Kelling are important for this is that what they have done is they've connected physical spaces with how people react in those environments. And so most importantly what they're saying is that if we don't deal with the broken window, you get increasing fear and you get increasing decline in neighbourhoods. These are the things that we need to focus on. Early intervention is much better than trying to deal with problems once they've become very serious indeed. And of course, some of these ideas were taken up in the United States, in New York, where they introduced what has become known as the zero tolerance policy on policing.
The zero tolerance approach, which is basically to remove all of the physical and social cues of within environments that cause this fear.
The emphasis was placed on dealing with the small problems, i.e. intervening early in the process.
Zero tolerance policies were implemented by the Mayor of New York, Rudy Giuliani.
The policies that arose as a result of what happened in New York were very important. The reason for that was that in terms of headline reductions in crime, there were huge reductions, 68% reductions over a 6 to 8 year period for a city that where crime was literally out of
control. Welcome back. So there we see, you know, broken windows policy at work. Now, since we have about only 8 minutes or so left, there is one video that I want to share with you all and hopefully discuss for the last 4 minutes. Maybe we'll watch part of it on the liberal prison system in Norway on Bastøy Island. So while that gets queued up, I'm going to jump around on some of the concepts. So for those of you who've taken the class, to make sure you read up on, definitely read up on white-collar crime. White-collar crime is are crimes committed by people in more affluent sections of society. Think tax fraud, antitrust violations, illegal sales practices, securities and land fraud, embezzlement, right? These are considered the crimes of the rich. But again, these crimes aren't prosecuted the same way because, you know, to a certain extent, they're not seen as violent or as ill for society. But again, you know, they do have a big impact, right? If you have, for example, if you're mugged and they take like your wallet, I mean, that's a very personal, that's a very real connection. But at the same time, you know, if someone robs you or takes, embezzles money from your retirement plan, that still has a very, big impact on your life. Corporate crimes, these are crimes committed by large corporations of society. And again, you know, this is pervasive and widespread. And again, there's six types: violations of administrative, environmental, financial, labor, manufacturing, and unfair practices. Like, for example, you know, if you buy something, there's a measurement on the bag or the box. That of the thing you're buying. If someone cheats you out of maybe an ounce or two, you might not notice, but still, they're stealing from you. And over, you know, if they do it to a whole population, you know, they end up making more money than, you know, it's done fraudulently. So what we're going to watch next, you know, to kind of give you something else to kind of think about, is within our society, within American society, you know, we have the largest prison population in the world. And for the most part, everyone understands that, you know, American prisons aren't very fun. They're very confined. They're very closed off. But what we're going to watch next is the liberal prison system in Norway. In the interest of time, we'll get that video started, and then we'll be back for a short discussion.
If you're planning to commit a crime and then have the misfortune of being caught, Norway might seem the right sort of place to do it. Certainly if you're sent to the country's flagship open prison, which you could easily mistake for a holiday camp. Situated on Bastøy Island on Oslo Fjord, prisoners can walk by the sea or take a swim. They live in shared apartments and there's no barbed wire or high walls in sight.
Bastøy Island is located about an hour from the Norwegian capital, tucked inside the Oslo Fjord. It's a slice of paradise featuring one of Norway's most beautiful beaches. Martin Reren has been here since May. He used to work on an oil rig, but now he cares for horses on the farm. Despite appearances, it's no island vacation. Bastøy is a prison for murderers, rapists, drug dealers and other criminals.
Once you accept the fact that you have to serve your sentence, it's a really nice prison. You can be outdoors a lot, in nature. It's prison, but I'm really happy here.
Bastøy is an open prison. Martin and his friend Chetil, who's in charge of feeding the cows here, take a bike ride around the island. They live in a cozy wooden house, free of prison walls, bars or guards. Martin and Chetil stay here with six other inmates. Each man has his own room and is free to decorate it as he wishes. Like in other shared accommodation, they take turns cleaning up. Prison director Arne Nielsen prefers this concept. He believes criminals shouldn't be punished any more than necessary.
We put the focus on the inmates. Humanity is the key. We give them the chance to find themselves, develop self-confidence, and change their lifestyle.
Okay, so welcome back. You know, here we see a short video. You know, it goes on for a little bit more if you want to, you know, internet search. The rest of it's Bastøy Island. There's a couple of, there's a lot of articles on it. But a big contrast to how we understand prison here in the United States. And again, this is kind of one of those discussions that, you know, kind of weigh, you know, this concept of whether, you know, how much punishment should fit the crime. So, you know, or what punishment or what this, you know, or how we should react to crime in our society, or what measures are appropriate, I should say. So in this case, many of you were, you know, might be thinking, well, these are murderers, these are rapists, these are probably the worst of Norwegian society. And, you know, they may be rewarded with, you know, a nice little vacation island, you know. Later on, you can see that, you know, they're pretty free. They're not really guarded. You know, there's only one guard or one or two guards at night. And, you know, they have accommodations that are quite comfortable, right? So, you know, some of you might feel outraged about that, right? But the other side is, you know, here in our prison system, we send, you know, offenders who, you know, deal with substance abuse or things like that to institutions that are very brutal and violent, right? So, you know, are we really, you know, approaching the problem the best way we can here in the United States? Again, you know, this is not an easy topic to, you know, kind of discuss. You know, hopefully you all are thinking a little bit more about your social world. But again, to kind of discuss the class, we have another exam up, you know, another paper will be due soon. So make sure you you start exploring those, and you know, next week we'll discuss you know, more sociology. So we'll see you all next time when you come back.